of people interested in this painting? What compels people? Why is this painting such a magnet for people? What does it have that makes people respond like that? Is it just because the painting is famous, because it's a famous story? Or does the painting have something intrinsically that radiates something that people need to see? I would say the latter. It's sort of a miracle that in his time, people didn't seem to see the beauty in what he was doing, but it seems like everyone can see it now for some reason. Time, who can figure that out? All of these complaints where people would say that Van Gogh didn't know how to draw, that his drawings were clumsy, and they just looked different than other people's work at the time. But when you get up close to this painting, or you look at this painting, and I guess what's happening is there's a couple of subjects here. One is to talk about people's response to the painting, and then the other is talking about how the painting responds to history and why this painting is good. So we can pick what we want to talk about first. Maybe we should start with why the painting is good. If you think in the most classic sense, and you think of, say, the drawings of Hans Holbein, that are very, very precise, particularly the way he would draw the fur, paint a fur collar or a fur hat. There are many small marks that are very, very clear. Also, if you think about Albrecht Dürer, I mean, there's a tradition of German and Dutch painting that this comes out of, even though it doesn't look like it, but when you get up close, you can see that if you look at the way he drew the line in his mouth, there's an Ehlers and crimson line. Probably it's hard to tell if it's Prussian blue or not, but you can see that there's some Prussian blue over here, and there's also ultramarine blue in the way where he's drawing in his eye, the line in his nose, and there's a spatial color. I mean, just by making this blue line under his nose here, you see the shadow under his nose. There's an economy of line that speaks back to antique painting, but because he separated things with color and texture, there's a radical new sensation that occurs, and the physicality of the painting, which probably disturbed people at the time, is the thing that draws people to the painting now. Because you can see how he made it, and at the same time, you see exactly how he made it, but you can't figure out how he did it because it looks like a miracle. The notion of an outline, where there's an outline of the figure, the body of the figure blends with the ground of the painting. So in a sense, the man himself is a landscape. We are impregnated in this life. We are a part of everything around us. And he is a part of everything around him, inside and outside of him. He's radiating out, and he is contained by time, terminal sense of life. How is that done? Or what does that have to do with? I mean, if you think of the way he's dealing with light, and you see the way the light is painted on his head, where the light's hitting his forehead, and you have this shape here. All of these shapes have their own autonomy in these paintings. And I think, in a sense, that gave birth to a lot of different kind of paintings where people focus on the marks rather than what the marks are illustrating. So I think this painting gave birth to a lot of different notions of painting. So what is it that makes it so popular? The scale of the head is the scale of reality. So essentially, this head is probably the same size as my head. And when you look at the painting, if you stand in front of the painting, is he you? Is a mirror of yourself in some way? The painting is not very big, but the scale is gigantic. So even though the painting's not big, the head is life size, and you just don't see the rest of the body. But he's there with you as if you were looking in the mirror, shaving in the morning or putting your makeup on. I just want to talk about light a little bit. I mean, I'm wearing blue glasses at the time. Everything I look at right now is a little bit more blue. The world looks a little better to me, a little bit more blue. Why is he green? I mean, people could have looked at the painting and said, well, that doesn't look very realistic, that your face is green. But the truth is that light changes all the time. And the thing that we learn to see or that we appreciate is when people can annotate the color of the day. If you think of Blinky Palermo's paintings, the time of the day, and they're just colors that are juxtaposed to other colors, they give you a feeling of a certain kind of light. In his paintings, he's breaking it down just to bands of color, and you have to make that leap, or the paintings do the gestalt for you. You fill in the blanks. This painting, you wonder, where is the light in this painting? And what's happening is, so the idea that they would have this thallo green that would be inside the middle of his face, or that his face would be green, there's a mixture of decisions about values and about things that you can't see. He's painting something that you can't see. And at a certain moment in his life, after seeing The Marriage at Cana by Veronese, he came back and he realized that the color in my paintings comes from my palette, not from reality. And that is a radical concept, and that is something that I think that he came to understand by looking at paintings that were made a few hundred years before he ever started. So it's painting is a continuum. One artist gives a letter to the next, to the people that are not born yet, and it continues. And that's how they transgress death. And that's what's so fascinating about the painting, because he may be dead, but his paintings certainly are not dead. And I think that people get that sense of immortality that makes them titillated in some way, and so the fascination with Van Gogh.